Welcome to the Good Fight Radio Show, a program dedicated to bringing you vital and uncompromised truths that you won't hear in the mainstream media, discussing contemporary issues in light of the Bible and how these issues relate to family, culture, and the church. The heart of this show is to glorify Jesus Christ and expose the works of darkness as He is commanded in Ephesians 5:11. Now here's your host, Good Fight Ministries' own Chad Davidson.
Welcome back to the Good Fight Radio Show. I'm your host, Chad Davidson of Good Fight Ministries. And with me, as always, is the president and founder of Good Fight Ministries and pastor of Blessed Hope Chapel in Simi Valley, California, Pastor Joe Schimmel. How are we doing today?
Rejoicing in Jesus, bro.
Amen to that. Also with us, as always, is the show's producer, Tony Palacio. How are you doing today, bro?
I'm doing awesome. I love going through scripture.
Amen. Amen to that. Amen to that. You're losing your voice there, it sounds like. But
I get so excited quoting Psalm 139.
That's right. That's right.
Doing that right before the show is beautiful.
Well, we're excited because we just talked about in our latest episode of Discipleship 101, we're talking about the attributes of God here. And the attribute that we talked about a number of them, but His omniscience, His omnipresence, His omnipotence, how powerful He is, that He's there in present, the fact that He is all-knowing, all-wise, He is spirit, all of these different attributes concerning the fact of asking the question, how big is our God?
And we've just been scratching the surface, man. There's so many wonderful attributes.
Amen. And also, alongside of that, we answered the question. Joe answered the question, why does it matter? And you saw over and over again, as Joe was explaining the different attributes of God, how a wrong view of God led to wrong doctrine.
That's right.
And wrong doctrine leads to wrong living.
Wrong living, that's right.
And then it leads you to the wrong afterlife, is where we're going to find out.
That's right, too.
And that is a perfect segue to the next attribute of God, and that has to do with God's holiness. And the question we're asking today is, how holy is your God?
Yeah, and we want to talk about two different types of holiness that God possesses within His attributes. All of His attributes relate to one another, but so within His attributes, they relate to one another. But when it comes to us, they relate to us in that one's communicable and one's not communicable. And what I mean by that, when we study the doctrine of God, there's certain attributes that God has that are incommunicable. They're just something that you and I could never even possibly possess that belong to God ontologically because of the class of being He is as the one true God. Nobody else could get close to being like Him in certain respects. And it is impossible.
Yeah, and we just talked about those attributes as well.
Yeah, some of those attributes, and we'll talk about more of them with regard to holiness because He's ontologically in a class of His own because He is uncreated. You could never be an uncreated person. It's impossible, okay? Absolutely. And that's against the very nature of God, you know? So, because He alone is the uncreated creator of all things. You could never be the creator of all things because He is the creator of all things, you know? And He already did it, you know? And He might allow you to take some of the stuff that He made out of matter and use it to make some craft or some do construction, what have you, but He's the creator of all things. So He's ontologically holy in that He is transcendent and separate from all of His creation in an ontological sense. And that's an incommunicable, those relate to His incommunicable attributes, as Chad was saying, like omnipresence we covered last episode and last discipleship training, omniscience and so forth. So when people come to you and say, hey, I'm God. I found out they're going to Word Faith Church or Prosperity Gospel Church or they're a New Ager. And I'm God. I realize I'm God. It's like, no, you're not. and actually, you're acting like a little demon, a little devil, because that's what Satan wanted to be. He wanted to pretend that he could become God, you know? And before I was a Christian and I did hallucinogens and so forth, you open your mind up through what the Bible calls pharmakeia to Satan's powers. You can come under, and I wrote a lyric. One of my lyrics was, I feel big, I feel godly. And when I wrote godly, I didn't mean it in the biblical sense. I didn't even know the biblical sense of the word godly. I meant like a god. And there are so many false demonic revelations that come to you when you get in the New Age movement and you get into, you know, certain kinds of drugs and what have you. And those are lies. The serpent told the beginning, you shall be as God. God is the only one who is God. And when I bowed the knee before the Lord Jesus Christ and began to read His word and just realize, hey, guess what? I am created. I'm not God. You know, and I never went around saying I'm God. That was one of the stupid lyrics I wrote. Nothing never was and always ever is, as though we are all eternal and a bunch of lies like that before I became a Christian. But God is ontologically holy. So he's holy in a sense that we will never be holy. He's transcendent over all of his creation, and he has self-existence. He exists of himself. We have only existence because of him. So there's many respects in which he is ontologically holy. And so many scriptures speak of how he alone is holy and so forth. In fact, in that sense, Psalm 99 verse 9 says, "Exalt the Lord for our God and exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy." I love Isaiah 6. It's one of my favorite passages in Isaiah. And we read in verse 1, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on his throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were the seraphs, the cherubim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying, and they were calling to one another, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory.'" So he's the Lord God Almighty. He's Yahweh there, Yahweh Almighty. And he's thrice holy, 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 holy. That could be said of no human being. And that's a reference to him being high and exalted, his ontological holiness. Revelation 4:11, we read, "And each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around and within. And day and night, they never stopped saying, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.'" And by the way, those angels that are doing this day and night are not doing it by compulsion. I mean, they're flying into the very presence of God. They could have left the presence of God as Lucifer and his angels do, and they're covering their faces when we read about the seraphim, that speaks of those who are on fire in the Hebrew. They're just shining ones, or there's bright because they're in the presence of God, and they're covering their faces with their wings, and they're the most powerful angelic beings we know of, perhaps the most powerful, and they're worshiping God in his holiness, and they're flying in his presence, and they cannot stay. He is so holy. They're so overcome with how powerful he is, how big he is, how holy and majestic he is, that they continue to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." I love Revelation 15:4. "Who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you," now check this out, guys, "for you alone are holy." Now, wait a minute. We're called to be holy. Talks about God's holy people. What is he saying there? That means that he alone is holy in the ontological sense. He alone is the creator, uncreated creator of all things. "For all the nations will come and worship before you, for your righteous acts have been revealed." And I love that passage because it talks about his ontological holiness, and he's worshiped because of it. And we will always be enamored and worship God in his holiness and cry out to him about how awesome he is. Think of the times, and probably each and every one of you have had an experience to one degree or another where you've just been in awe of God's creation, whether it's a sunset, whether it's some beautiful landscape or a huge canyon or the beach at sunset or sunrise. I mean, just seeing something radical in nature that God made where you're just like dumbfounded, you're in awe. Multiply that by millions of times. When you're in the presence of God, it's going to be so jaw-dropping. All you're going to be able to say is, "You are holy, you know, Lord God Almighty," you know, and start speaking of his attributes. And we need to recognize these things now. We shouldn't wait until we get into his actual presence, because Jesus said, "Pray this way, hallowed be thy name." Amen. So we're supposed to be asking God to help us recognize his holiness and declare his holiness to those around us. And I constantly pray, and I pray that's your prayer as well, that you say, "God, have mercy on me and help me to see how holy you are and help me to communicate that holiness to others." And by the way, I pray that prayer, and guess what? I'm able to share it with a lot of people because we pray according to God's will, we have it. And part of his will is that his name is shown to be holy. And guys, when you look at his holiness, you're speaking of his transcendence above all things.
Yeah, I think one of the more important things when you're talking about God's attributes, when we're talking about these things, is that it should have an effect on your day-to-day life as a believer. It should have an effect. Studying doctrine, studying different, like the attributes of God, and studying these things philosophically as well, and understanding them, all Amen. They should do is change your life accordingly. When you see how holy he is, when you see he's omnipresent, when you see he's, you know, all-powerful, when you see he's almighty God, these things should have a practical influence on your day-to-day life and how you live. And so here's a question I think is a good time to posit it, is how does God's ontological holiness differ from his ethical holiness?
No, and that's a great question, because when we speak of his ontological holiness, we speak of him being separate and distinct from all of his creation as a class of being, of who he is. But when we speak of his ethical holiness, we're speaking of the fact that he is also separate from moral evil, okay? He's separate from that which is sinfully repugnant to who he is as God, and he's separate from that which is wicked. And that's the way in which, now that's a communal attribute. We can never become God and become holy in the transcendent sense and become the uncreated creator of all things, but we can decide to abstain from that which is evil and hate that which is evil and cling to that which is good and walk in holiness. We're called over and over again to be holy as the Lord God is holy. So he calls us creatures to be holy in the ethical sense, in the sense that we live a moral life and we shun evil, and that we don't get involved in sexual sin. We don't get involved in committing violence against other people. We don't get involved in gossip and running people down and trying to hurt people. We don't get involved in, you know, just unforgiveness and malice. We say, Lord, help us to be like you. So in that sense, we're talking about his ethical holiness. And there's many scriptures that deal with that. Psalm 5:4 says, "For you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness. No evil dwells with you." So he is a God that's separate from wickedness. Habakkuk 1:13, the first part of that verse says, "Your eyes are too pure to approve evil, and you cannot look on wickedness with favor." And then we see he calls us to be holy in that sense, in the way he is holy, separate from that which is morally evil. And we read in 1 Peter 1:15 and 16, "But like the Holy One who called you, like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior, because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy." I love that. Because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. James 1:13 says, "Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself does not tempt anyone." So God is morally holy, he's ethically holy. And in Hebrews 12:10, we're told that God's discipline is intended to make us as children of God partakers of sharers and sharers in his holiness. And that if we don't partake of his ethical holiness, we won't see the Lord. In fact, we read in Hebrews chapter 12, "They disciplined us," speaking of our earthly parents, "for a little while as they thought best. But God disciplines us for good, for our good, in order that we may share in his holiness." So we can share, even though it says in, was it Revelation 15:4, that he alone is holy, we can't share his ontological holiness, but he disciplines us, so we'll share in his ethical holiness. So they discipline us, so we'd be, you know, we do what's, you know, what was best for us. But he goes on to say that God disciplines us for our good, in order that we may share in his holiness. Then it goes on to say, in verse 14 and 15, right around there, "Make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy." So we're supposed to pursue holiness, "without which no one will see the Lord," the King James. Another translation, "without holiness, no one will see the Lord." So we want to make sure that we're not living wicked lives, or we will not see the Lord.
Amen. Amen. His holiness should be something that tells us to live a holy
Amen.
Life.
Amen. Like Amen. You said, it should translate to our boots, our feet, how we live, how we walk.
Amen. And this next attribute, I think that not only has a lot to do with holiness, but also it's one that has been, I guess, bent or just mangled
misunderstood
by the world. In fact, Oprah Winfrey said that she basically no longer believed in the God of the Bible because of this attribute.
That's right.
And it has to do with whether or not our God is truly a jealous God.
And the answer to that is absolutely, God is a jealous God. Jealousy is one of his attributes. If he is truly loving and truly cares to protect those he loves against evil, he's going to be jealous of that which they would go to that would be destructive. In fact, it's interesting because throughout Scripture, you see the threat of false demon gods. You know, the gods of nations are demons and all these idols. In fact, the most repeated sin we see in Scripture throughout the Old Testament by far and away is a fallen to false gods, idolatry. And God draws the connection from idolatry to adultery. And he uses the picture of adultery among humans so we might understand how he feels in regard to when his people seek other gods. And I think this is important because there are scriptures where, I mean, he uses some really graphic language. He talks to his Israelites and he says, Ezekiel, you know, what mountain did you not go up to and spread your legs for a false god? I mean, that's radical language. And it's like graphic, but why is he being that way? Because he's letting us know that just as a wife would go to other men and sleep with them, and that would be repugnant. A man who, if a man finds out that his wife had slept with somebody and was sleeping with all these different guys, he said, oh, no big deal. I'm not jealous. I'm not concerned about that. Would he really care about her? Would he really love her? Would he really value their relationship? Absolutely not. So jealousy, and we're talking about what the Bible calls godly jealousy. The Bible talks about sinful anger, but also talks about godly anger, righteous indignation. It says, be angry and sin not. In other words, you can have anger over something that's evil without sinning. In fact, if I saw my mom get beat up by somebody and I'm down the road and I'm seeing it happening and I didn't get angry at what that person is doing, you know, God help me to not sin when I catch him, right? But I'm telling you right now, I would be in a condition if I didn't have any anger. I mean, she's in her 80s now. I wouldn't be a good son, you know? But you could have a righteous indignation that could spurn you on to doing what's righteous, okay? So when it comes to godly jealousy, which the Bible mentions in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we're talking about a jealousy that's perfectly pure and holy. And the reason it's so hard to understand, when Oprah Winfrey's judging God, oh, he's a jealous God, she's looking at her, she's got the Gumby thing going on. She's looking at her own sinful type of jealousy. And she's projecting, oh, well, if he's jealous like that, and maybe she's jealous of somebody who got to, you know, end up marrying a guy she likes. I don't know what's going on. But she puts that on God. She misunderstands who God is. God is perfectly jealous in a perfectly righteous way. For instance, if, you know, my daughters are married, and Chad, you're married to one of them, of course, and my son isn't yet married, but now I have these granddaughters, and Chad, you've given me a couple of them, right? And your daughters, Chad, somebody knocks at your door, and they want to take out your daughter, and she's 25, and you're allowing her to date for the first time, and have Christian type of courtship, possibly, and you're like, yeah, you can go out with us, you know, we'll hang out with you, because she's, you know, but the guy, you know, he's got a swastika and a pentagram tattooed in his forehead, you know, and he has a shirt that says, I love Satan, you know, and you wouldn't say, oh yeah, that's great. You would, and all of a sudden, you know, he has a chance to see her and court her or what have you. And if you were just like, oh, that's all cool. You know, that's really good. This is, come right in, you know, and you're not jealous for her well-being and concerned about as your daughter, that she'd be in the right place. This is actually a scriptural kind of jealousy, which is good, where your heart would be upset, like, well, where's this guy taking her? What would be going on with this guy and her? You wouldn't even let her get out the door. You'd put yourself between him and her. In fact, in Exodus chapter 20, verses 5 and 6, the Lord says, within the Ten Commandments given to the Jews, you shall not worship them, speaking of these false gods, or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children, on the third and the fourth generations, to those of those who hate me, it's for those who hate him, but showing loving kindness to thousands, to those who love me, and those who keep my commandments. Exodus 34:14. I love this passage on the jealousy of God. For you shall not worship any other god, for the Lord whose name is jealous, I love this, for the Lord whose name is jealous is a jealous God. And that's because he loves us, right? And it's interesting, in 4:4, James 4:4, where they're loving the world, you know? Yeah.
Adulteresses.
And he says, you adulteresses, know ye not that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever makes himself a friend of the world makes himself the enemy of God. You can go from having a relationship with God and become a spiritual adulteress, because we're the bride of Christ, by putting things before him, loving pleasures more than God, loving more money more than God, loving self more than God. 2 Corinthians 11:2-3 is significant. Paul says, because Paul knows the Lord now, he didn't have these feelings for the church. He was having the church killed before he became a believer, right? When he was a Pharisee. But now he's jealous for the church. Does that mean he's got this wrong heart? No, because he has a godly jealousy, because he has the love of God in him. The love that Paul had for even his own kin, the Israelites, was such that he said he would give his own life and allow himself to become accursed if they could be saved. So Paul has the love of God, as he mentioned, shed abroad in his heart, in our hearts, right? In 2 Corinthians 11, 2 and 3, Paul says, "For I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy. For I betrothed you to one husband." This is back to the analogy I used with you and, say, Ariella, you know, one of your daughters. "For I betrothed you to one husband so that to Christ I might present you as a pure virgin. But I'm afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, your minds will be led astray for the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ." So there's a godly jealousy being spoken of there. That's very important. And when we ignore these attributes of God, and what happens? You don't recognize that God is a God that made you. And by the way, by virtue of the fact that he is our creator, we belong to him. By virtue of the fact that Jesus died for us, we ought to say no to the world and yes to Jesus. But what happens with Oprah Winfrey? She doesn't fear the true God. She doesn't love the true God. She doesn't want to accept him for who he is, as one that's concerned that she has a relationship with him and doesn't have rival thrones and demon gods, which these rival thrones, these demon gods, are ultimately for the eternal detriment of whoever worships them. So God's jealousy is to protect us and his relationship with us from Satan and the fallen angels. It's so important to understand that. It's based on his love for us and his desire for our eternal well-being. And we understand that from a biblical perspective, it becomes a very beautiful thing. If my wife would never, ever get jealous of anything that I would do, and I could just do all these terrible things, she wouldn't really love me. I realize she doesn't love me. Now, somebody could become overly jealous, but that is not a godly jealousy that Paul speaks about. That's not the biblical jealousy. So never think of God's anger to be tinged with even an iota of sinfulness. Never think of God's jealousy to be tinged with an iota of shifting or shadow or darkness. He's perfectly holy in all of his attributes, and they all blend together perfectly, and him being a jealous God is a beautiful thing. That means he loves us, and he cares about us, and he wants to protect us.
Yeah, amen. I think that's something that's really important, and it's going to, I think, go smoothly into the last attribute we're going to talk about in this specific episode. And I think that this one is another one that kind of can be some pendulum swinging, so to speak, with those who believe something false about it. But I do believe that it is a part of, kind of like a subplot of, the entire story of holiness in God. And that has to do with his wrath and whether or not God is wrathful.
Yeah, God is definitely wrathful. There are, as you said, Chad, people that misunderstand this attribute. Some of them see God as being, seeing God's wrath as a necessary aspect of his being, which you had brought up before the show. And that's R.C. Sproul Jr., not his father, but R.C. Sproul Jr., seemed to present God as this kind of, even before he creates mankind, have this smoldering wrath in his heart, as though he's just burning with anger. And he just needs to let it out on somebody. So it creates humanity, and he predestines the greater part of humanity. I don't know if he'd say the greater part, but if you're going to go with Jesus saying only a few enter the narrow gate, but the broad way goes to destruction, those who perish are the greater part. But we don't believe they're predestined to hell or predetermined to go there. But R.C. Sproul believes in Junior, as well as Senior, believed in a, kind of like a double predestination, that he predestines people to hell. Well, R.C. Sproul Jr. taught that God's wrath is like a necessary part of his being in respect to, it's just who he is. And when he creates people, he wants to exercise that attribute. So he creates a bunch of people just to destroy them and watch them burn. Okay, that is just a twisted, demonic view of the wrath of God. I'm sorry to say, it really is. But then you have the liberal side, the other side of the pendulum, right? Where you have guys like, you know, William Young, or you have the author of The Shack, you know, who teaches a form of universalism, or, for instance, you know, Rob Bell. Everybody, you know, love wins, everybody's going to be saved. And these guys basically do away with the wrath of God. In fact, we did a 2.5-3 hour expose on The Shack, exposing the errors of The Shack.
And it's called The Shack of Lies. We have it available on our website. Yep,
that's right, called The Shack of Lies. And we show where he denies that God is a God of wrath. And we just quote scripture after scripture after scripture showing that God is a God of wrath. Now, the aspect of God's nature that displays wrath, we believe, is born out of his holiness and born out of his love in response to sin. Okay? So when mankind or demons, Satan in the demonic realm, fallen angels, humans begin to worship that which is, or begin to worship self, or rebel against God and his holiness and who he is, and want to be God, which is an aberration. It's a fundamental distortion of reality, because as we mentioned, there can only be one true God. It's only one uncreated creator of all things. If they want to bend reality and pretend that they are God, like Satan wanted to be like the most high God, right? Eve said that she wanted to become as God. Adam partakes of the forbidden fruit. The Antichrist will sit in the temple of God, show himself that he is God. When people begin to be their own gods and or put gods before God and distort reality, which is very, very, very destructive, by the way, not only for the person doing that, for other people that are being led astray by them, they're being led away from the only true fountain of life, the Lord God. God's wrath is exercised out of his love, out of his holiness. It's not a necessary part of his being before, as far as a response, something that's always taking place, where he's a God of wrath before creation, and he's just smoldering with wrath, wanting to create people he's going to have wrath on. No, it comes from him responding to rebellion against him because he is holy and because he is love. So it's important to understand these attributes tonight. We sure hope that you guys are understanding and following along the best you can, and really appreciating who God is and how his attributes work together. In fact, there are many scriptures that speak of God being a God of wrath. In fact, he says he's a God of vengeance, speaks of him unsheathing his sword against that which is evil. It says in Revelation 19 that Jesus tramples underfoot the winepress of God's wrath on the day of his wrath. In Isaiah chapter 63, verse 2, it says, "Why is your apparel red?" Because Jesus comes back in Revelation 19 and his robe is dipped in blood. It's interesting, in Isaiah 63, we have some commentary on that. "Why is your apparel red, and your garments like one who treads the winepress? I have trodden the wine trough alone, and from the peoples there was no man with me. I also tread them in my anger, and I trample them in my wrath, and their lifeblood is sprinkled on my garments, and I stained all my remnant. For the day of the vengeance was in my heart, and my year of redemption has come." He goes on to say he did this by himself. By the way, you don't have any dominion theology there of Christians taking over the world and then giving it to Christ as a present when he comes back. Christ comes back and brings his wrath. He's the one that comes to dominate the world as the rightful heir of all things. In Romans 1:18 through 20, it says, "The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known about God is evident within them. For God made it evident to them, for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse." Hebrews 12, 28 and 29. "Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace," or receive grace, "by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire." We need to allow these holy attributes and how awesome and great our God is, and that he is a holy God, just relate to how we respond to him. In fact, how did Isaiah respond when he saw the angels, the seraphim worshiping, "Holy, holy, holy is Lord God Almighty"? He said, "Woe is me, I am undone. I'm from a people of unclean lips," you know. And then he's like, "God, send me. I mean, I want to serve you." What did Job do when he saw God in a whirlwind, man? He put his hand over his mouth. He was in sackcloth and became silent before the Lord, you know, and realized how awesome the Lord God is. What did John do, the apostle, when Jesus appeared before him in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, he fell down
as a dead man
when Jesus' face shined like the sun. Man, you guys, our God is radical. Bow before him and get excited about Jesus and make his name and his attributes known. Hallowed be thy name, Lord God.
Amen.
You've been listening to the Good Fight Radio Show, brought to you by Good Fight Ministries. If you're blessed by this show and would like to partner with us, won't you consider visiting our support page at goodfight.org? Or you can write to us at P.O. Box 2202, Simi Valley, California, 93062, or call us toll-free at 1-866-JC-TRUTH. That's 1-866-528-7884. We hope you'll tune in next time on the Good Fight Radio Show.